Hi folks, hope you're okay today. It's good to be with you. We're looking at a few Bible teaching messages, and we've got some apologetic messages coming up on Islam and answering Islam. So it's good to see you, and we're looking at Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. So if you'd like to turn to Galatians chapter 1. Sorry. Excuse me. Galatians chapter 1. Excuse me. Let's pray. Father God, we come before you today. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor. And Father, I just pray for this message that you bless it to our hearts in your name and for your glory, Lord. Amen. Amen. Looking at Galatians chapter 1. Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. And all the brethren which are with me unto the children of Galatia, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. And from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, who himself for our sins that he might deliver us, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory for ever and ever. Amen. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be there some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, and so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which you have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which is preached of me is not after men, for I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Christ, Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my conversations in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb, and called me by his grace to reveal his Son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. Neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. That after 3 years I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. But other of the apostles saw I none save James, the Lord's brother. Now the things which I write unto you, behold, before God I lie not. Afterwards I came into the region of Syria and Cilicia, and was unknown by face unto the churches of Judea which were in Christ. But they had heard only that he which persecuted us in times past now preacheth the faith which once he destroyed, and they glorify God in me. The message of this sermon is the simplicity of the gospel. Do you remember the film that came out about the Titanic? And in that film, the Titanic's going along the water, and there's a man who's on the post looking out to see if there's any dangers, and he doesn't see the iceberg until it's too late, when the Titanic scrapes on the iceberg and then the iceberg cuts the Titanic and the Titanic begins to sink. And in a way, there's the iceberg coming towards the gospel in this modern age. There are many, many groups and movements and things that are coming into the church that are trying to undermine the simplicity of the gospel, and we have to be alert. In Acts chapter 16, verse 6, Acts chapter 13, Acts chapter 18, 23, these are areas where Paul visited. They are South Galatia and North Galatia. South Galatia was very more like farming area, and North Galatia was more commerce. And Paul, in this book, he's writing to Galatians. Scholars argue, is it South or North Galatia he's writing to? But he's writing to Galatia in that whole area. And he's writing about an issue of Judaizing, that there were people in the church that wanted to make people Jews and moved people away from the simplicity of the gospel. You can see that in Galatians chapter 1, verse 12. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it by the revelation of Jesus Christ, for you have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. So here's a man, he's saying, look, these people who were Judaizers, who were trying to make you a Jew, that you would get circumcised, those who were trying to do that, I was like them. I was the top man. I was the top Jew of the Jews. I was the top person who said, in order for you to be saved, you needed to be circumcised. But then he's saying, but when it pleased God, verse 15, who separated me from my mother's womb, called me by the grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. I was the top Judaizer, but now I have faith in Jesus. The simplicity of the gospel is his main focus. That was the issue for Paul, that he had faith in Christ and he wanted others, whether Jew or Gentile, to have that faith in him and not to become, to be sidelined or have your relationship with God destroyed by saying that you need to do some kind of work to get saved. If you turn to Colossians chapter 2, verse 16. Colossians chapter 2, verse 16. Colossians chapter 2, verse 16, it says, let no man therefore judge you in meat or drink or in respect of a holiday or of a new moon or of a Sabbath day. There were people who were even going around saying, you know, you've got to worship God on this special Jewish holiday or this special day or whatever. And it was becoming trying to push people into getting saved by getting into all these weird and wonderful things. And what Paul is saying in this book is, no, we've got to keep to the simple faith in Jesus. That's the issue. Around about 2006, an archbishop, Catherine somebody, I can't remember her last name, she became an archbishop in the Episcopal Church of America, and she was on record of saying that she thought that people who believed the gospel were narrow-minded and closing God in a box, so that they weren't open to the possibility of, you know, a wider salvation, i.e. people getting saved outside Jesus Christ. She was a archbishop, she's retired now from being the archbishop, but she was a leader of over 2 million people in American Episcopal Church. 2 million people were influenced by this false teaching. So that's an example of how we've got to be careful that these things can come into any group, any denomination, where people are turned away or taught false teaching away from the simplicity of the gospel. Number one, the channel of the gospel. Galatians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. Paul was an apostle. He was one of the 12, one of the 13. He was 12, and then there was 13. Sorry, I've got an itchy nose. And he was chosen by God to do his ministry. If you read Acts chapter 9, verse 15 to 18, God specifically said he'd chosen Paul. Sorry, I've got a itchy nose. I always get an itchy nose when I'm preaching. Sorry. Sorry. I think it's just nerves, I think. So, Paul was called as an apostle. He had authority as an apostle. If we want to know about the gospel, we go to the apostolic teaching. There are many today who are looking to spiritual gurus on the television, or spiritual leaders, or spiritual movements, or they're looking at a person, or a leader, or a church, or a group. And if you do that, or a certain book, or they run around for this conference and that conference, and they try to get a blessing or whatever, but they're thinking that this is the main thing, and they're not realizing that it's the simplicity of the gospel. We're not to follow men, we're not to follow spiritual gurus, because they can let us down, they can lead us astray. We're to follow the apostolic teaching. That is the channel. And Paul was called to be a teacher of the gospel. The blessings of the gospel. If I go to a restaurant where... Sorry about this, it's just a terrible habit when I'm preaching. If you go to a restaurant where it's good food and clean and hygienic, you get a blessing. But if you go to a restaurant where they've got no hygiene policy, where the cook doesn't cook the food properly, doesn't wash his hands, is not clean, you're going to get poisoned. And Paul is warning us that if we turn away from the simplicity of the gospel, we'll get poisoned with bad teaching. But if we turn to the gospel, we get blessing. Galatians chapter 1 verse 3, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Grace, undeserved mercy, peace, shalom. There's blessings in Christ if we trust in him. We turn to Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7. And like I said, people can run around to different meetings. They can try to read a book and think, oh, this new book's come out and it'll give me what I need, or I'll go and see this spiritual guru and they'll help me, or this movement, this group, they've got all what I need. No, Christ is all that you need. Ephesians 1 verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. According to the riches of his grace. All our blessings are in Christ. The meaning of the gospel. If I was to go into... Imagine you was on a plane and there's about eight of you and it crashes into the middle of the Sahara Desert. And there's bottles of water in the fridge of the plane. You take all these bottles of water, you open them up, you put them in a bucket. So now you've got one bucket of water in that plane. That's all you've got. There's no water for thousands of miles. All you have is that bucket with that water. That's all you have. You can go and dig a hole. You can go sit under a palm tree. You can go anywhere you want, but you cannot get any water. The only water that you can get is from that bucket. That is the gospel. The only place you can get saved is by knowing the gospel and believing it. Galatians chapter 1 verse 4, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God our Father. Notice, who gave himself for our sins. For our sins. The Greek for as the idea of substitution. For our sins. He gave for our sins. He died on our behalf. Mark chapter 10, 45. Mark chapter 10. 45. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. Give his life a ransom for many. It's like the story of story of a millionaire, and he had a son, and he had a picture of his son made and painted, but just by an ordinary artist. His son died in the war, and the millionaire, after a few years, he died. And this millionaire had lots of great paintings full of great, amazing art. And when he died, everybody turned up to buy the artwork or to receive a will to see if they got anything from him. And they turned up, and there was all these people. And before the will was read out, they auctioned a painting, and it was a picture of his son. It was a scruffy picture, not worth much. Nobody wanted to buy it. No one would bid for it. No one bothered about it. But one lady, a cleaner in the mansion, bought it. She bought that. When she bought it, they read the will, and the will said this: "Whoever bought the picture of my son inherits everything." And that is the gospel. If we trust in Jesus Christ, we have everything that we need in him for forgiveness and being right with God. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9, "Whom God has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, who hath saved us and called us." He saved us and called us. That's the meaning of the gospel, that Christ died on our behalf. Jesus stepped in your place and died that you may live. That is the only way to get saved. If you try to earn your way to heaven, you're not going to get there. If you try to do good deeds, you're not going to get there. If you try to earn it by religion, you're not going to get there. You have to come and realize, you know what? I'm a sinner, and I need to believe in Jesus that he died for me. That's the gospel. The reason for the gospel, you know, when these car companies make a new car, like a Ferrari, they'll put it in a great hall, and they'll put it on in a with lights on and shining, and they bring all the press down and all the film crews and say, look, you know, look at this amazing new car, and the lights will be flashing, and they'll display this car. Well, that is the gospel, is a display of the majesty and the glory of God. Galatians 1 verse 5, "When I call to remembrance the unfeigned," sorry, Galatians 1 5, "to whom be glory forever and ever, amen." The glory of God is important. And we've become too man-centered. We've become too bothered about what people think. If pastors and leaders are so interested in what the world thinks and pandering to the world, they'll dumb down the gospel. They'll shape the gospel to fit the spirit of the age. But we need to have a vision for the glory of God and not to be frightened of men. Calvin and the reformers were interested in the glory of God. They believed that the gospel was a display of the glory of God, and they wanted God to be glorified. That's why they wanted to preach the gospel, because they could see it was God's love and mercy shining through that gospel. Revelation 4:11. We need to be a people who seek the glory of God rather than pleasing men. Revelation 4 verse 11. Revelation 4 verse 11 says, "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things for thy pleasure. They were created." It's all for the glory of God. That is the reason for the gospel. The battle for the gospel. Imagine you're on a ship in the African Ocean somewhere. This ship runs aground and begins to sink. Now you're the captain, and you've got your goggles, and you're looking to make sure that the people get off the boat, get onto the lifeboats, and you're looking for any hope people coming to help you. You can see two ships coming towards you. One ship from the left and one ship from the right. The one on the right, you notice through your goggles, have got machine guns, and they clearly look like pirates. The one on the left look like government officials and really want to help you. If you care about the people, you're going to say, "Don't go that way in the lifeboats. Don't go to that boat. It's a dangerous boat. they're pirates. If you love them, you'll warn them and say, go to that boat, that's the boat that you can be saved. But today, the politically correct in world that we live in, and in the world in the church where they don't want to upset anybody, they'll say this, oh, you mustn't warn them. Don't warn them because it's all the same. That boat and that boat, they're all the same, and you're going to upset people's feelings. And there's no really one way. There's all ways are the same. Really? If they go to that way, they're going to get killed by the pirates. Don't go that way. And it's the same with the gospel. Oh, don't preach the gospel because it'll upset people, it'll offend people, it's not inclusive, whatever. Yeah, but if you don't preach the gospel, people are going to go to hell. Galatians chapter 1 verse 6. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you unto the grace of Christ unto another gospel. He's not politically correct here. He's concerned about the souls of men and women. I marvel, the Greek there has to have the idea of I'm blown away, I'm totally shocked. He was just shocked that they was moving away from the simplicity of the gospel. If you was to read, do a study, if you want to do a study, Romans chapter 1 verse 8 to 15. Here Paul prays for the people. In 1 Corinthians 1, 4 and 9, Paul prays. Philippians 1, 3, 11, Paul prays for the people. Colossians 1, 3, 8, he prays for the people. 1 Thessalonians 1, 2 and 10, he prays for the people. But here, he hasn't got time to pray. He says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. I'm shocked. I'm dumbfounded. You're blowing my mind. What are you going down the religious way for? You need to get back to the simplicity of Christ. We turn to the book of Jude, verse 3. Beloved, when I give all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. The battle for the gospel. There are some people who like to fight theologically about anything. That is a wrong spirit. We should be a people who want to be united with God's people. If you read the book of Philippians, it talks about unity. We've got to try to be united with the people of God. So I'm not advocating that we always pick in a fight, theological fight with people. But what I am advocating is that when the gospel is being undermined, that is a time to stand and fight and to say enough's enough. You've got to be willing to battle. This is not going to be a year to keep your head in the sand. It's not going to be a year to ignore the writing on the wall. There are movements, there are groups, there are leaders, there are things coming into the church, and they are coming fast, and they are coming to take down the simplicity of the gospel. And you've got to be ready, and you've got to be prepared to fight in that battle. Whether you're a pastor, whether you're a youth worker, whether you're a Sunday school worker, whoever you are, you have got to be prepared and ready, and you have got to take action to defend the simplicity of the gospel. There can be no shirking, there can be no ducking, there can be no saying, I don't want to upset anybody. No, when the gospel is being threatened, you've got to make that stand. Simple as. It's not a time for being squeamish. It's not a time for saying it's not going to make me popular or it's going to upset people. No. There are times when you have to say a spade is a spade. There are times when you have to say, no, this is undermining the gospel. This is undermining the gospel. And I have to speak out. I have to say it. And you have to say it. And it might be a long, protracted battle. It might be a battle that you have to fight year in, year out, week in, week out. It might have to go on for a long time. You've got to be willing to not let this go. The battle is coming to us. The war is coming to us. The war is coming to the church. The war is coming to us, and we cannot sit down. We cannot put our heads in the sand. These things are coming in to undermine the simplicity of the gospel. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. I'm shocked. I'm dumbfounded. You have to be concerned if the gospel is being undermined. Enemies of the gospel. Galatians chapter 1 verse 8. But though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let it be accursed. Why does he say that? Because, my friends, listen to me. I'm going to say this. People are going to go to hell if they get a wrong gospel. People's lives are going to go to hell. So if these people are propagating a gospel that is a false gospel, it's going to send people to hell. So if they're going to send people to hell with their false gospel, then cursed be them. There are enemies trying to undermine the gospel. The greatest threat to the gospel today is Islam. Islam wants to undermine the gospel and take us back to the law. Humanism is a danger. It wants to take us under rationalism. There's mysticism where people want to gain all these mystical experiences, but they don't want the simplicity of Christ. There's Judaism. People want to take us back into Judaism. Paul was a Jew. He loved being a Jew, but he put Christ first. But there are people who want to put Judaism first before Christ. There is an intellectualism that is a danger. People want to be... I love apologetics. But there are people who have become too intellectual rather than keeping to the simplicity of the gospel. I've been spending this week, I've been studying the Talmud, I've been studying the Dead Sea Scrolls, reading Philo, reading the Book of Enoch, reading modern scholarship. I've been reading intellectual stuff, but I will never ever move away from the simplicity of the gospel. Traditionalism, people wanting to be traditional. People wanting to be modern, and they think being modern and culturally sophisticated, and they move away from the simplicity of the gospel. Scholarship has been like an acid in the evangelical church. We've been in the Enlightenment for 300 years, and it's rather like this. If you get a bunch of lepers, and you go and play and sit amongst the lepers, you're going to get leprosy. And for 300 years, modern scholarship has been attacking the Bible, and these evangelical scholars have been in the universities getting their PhDs amidst the skepticism attack upon the Bible, and they've caught the measles of this evil. And they don't even realize it. Just like you would sit amongst lepers and you catch leprosy, they've sat amongst modern scholars with their anti-Christ and anti-God. And evangelical scholars have caught it without even realizing it. They don't even realize they've caught it. When you adopt secular methodologies like form criticism and things like that, and which undermine the integrity of the text, you don't realize you've been captured by the spirit of the age. And Paul was saying, look, these enemies are destroying the gospel. And he always brought people back to the gospel. Ephesians chapter 2. That is your job as a minister. It's your job as a leader. It's your job as a leader, as a minister, to bring people back always to the gospel. Ephesians 2 verse 8 and 9. For by grace you are saved through faith and not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Paul declares the simplicity of the gospel, that Christ is our salvation. So in the final conclusion, what is my message to you? What am I trying to say? Turn to Galatians chapter 1 verse 4. Galatians chapter 1 verse 4. It says, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us, notice, that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God our Father. Notice, that he might deliver us from this present evil world. He might deliver us from this present evil world. Do you realize the implications of that? What he's saying is, look, this world is finished. This world is gone. This world is going to be destroyed. It's an evil world and it's going to be destroyed. All the people around you today, all that you see in one day is going to be destroyed. And when the Lord came and when the Lord died on the cross, the new kingdom came in. But it didn't come in its fullness. It came in part. It was purchased for us by Christ. But one day he's coming back and the fullness of the kingdom will be experienced by us. But now we've tasted a bit of the glory. But Christ died for us. And that cross is the doorway to the new kingdom, which is here partly, but will come in its fullness in the future. That is the age that we're living in. We're living in an evil age, but the kingdom has come in and not come in its fullness. But it will come in its fullness one day when the Lord comes. But we taste part of the glory now in Jesus Christ. And you are the guardians and the defenders of that truth, of that doorway, which is the gospel. It's kind of like this. Imagine that we are knights, and we are knights. We have our shield and our armor and our sword, and we have the St. John's cross on our shield, and we have the St. John's cross on our armor, and there's this castle, and there's a bridge going over the river to the castle, and we're stood at the bridge. And the villagers are running away from the evil of the time, and they're running to the bridge, and we're to protect the bridge so that people could get across the bridge into the peace of the castle. And as we're standing there, and as the villagers are coming and running for their lives, dragons swoop down and we bash them away from the people. There are goblins and witches and evil spirits that are coming down to attack the people and to stop them from going into the castle. But we stand there with our shields and our swords and we fight and we battle the demons. We battle the dragons. We're battling and fighting them. And as we fight them, we keep that doorway open so the boys and girls and men and women can walk through that, over that bridge into the castle. When Paul says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you unto another grace or to another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. He is being one of those knights where he's standing there and he's saying, I'm keeping the door of the gospel open that men and women may run through and be saved, and I'm not allowing any evil or anyone to stop the preaching of the gospel or being perverted in any way, because this is the only way that can be saved. And he fights like a man standing for the truth of the gospel, because he knows this is life and death. Men and women are going to go to hell if this false teaching gets a grip on the church. And right now, God is calling you to be a defender of the gospel. You are to hold the line. And you are to stand like a man and woman for the truth. And you're to be there proclaiming the gospel, defending the gospel, propagating the gospel. And the evil will try to come in. Men will try to pervert the gospel with false teaching, false teachers, denominations, leaders, big cheeses, people with PhDs, people who say they've had charismatic experiences, cults, religions, philosophies. They're all coming and they're all attacking, and you are to stand like a man, stand like a woman, and stand and say, no, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you unto the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we are an angel or heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. And we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which you have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For I yet please men, I should not be a servant of Christ. The Greek there, servant, is a bond servant, a slave of Christ. I have no choice. You have no choice. This is not a matter of opinion. We are slaves to Christ, called to proclaim him, called to defend him, called to lift him up. And we will not go down the way of religion. We will not go down the way of philosophy. We will not go down the way of cults. We will lift him up. And we will proclaim him. And we will set him amongst the nations. We will set him amongst the church. And we'll say, here he is, Christ crucified. A stumbling block to the Jews. It's not wisdom to the Greeks. But Christ crucified. My Lord died. My Lord shed his blood. My Lord gave his life. Turn to him. Trust in him. And depart from these philosophies. Depart from these cults. Depart from this religious nonsense. And turn to the blessed Savior. And trust him as your Savior. And believe in him. And rest in him. And say, glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb that was slain. So, my friends, you are called to be defenders of the faith and to proclaim the gospel in your generation. And you might get battered to the left, you might get battered to the right, you might be inflicted with wounds, and you might have even chunks of your flesh taken out, but you are to stand and to proclaim the gospel in your generation, so that men and women and boys and girls might run over that rampart into the castle of salvation, saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. That is your job today. And in this coming year, the gospel will be assaulted left, right and center. And you must not flinch, and you must not put your head in the sand. But you must stand up and be a man, stand up and be a woman, and proclaim the gospel in your generation. God bless you. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love and your grace. There is an eternity and people are going to hell and heaven. And Lord, you have called your people to stand for the gospel. This is not a game. This is not entertainment. This is reality. You died on that cross, you shed your blood, and you give your life, and we are not to mess with the gospel, we're not to change the gospel, we're not to play with the gospel. We are to proclaim the gospel. And I pray for those who heard this message today that you will give them the strength to, and the courage to fight for the truth and to fight for the gospel, to do it in love and grace and gentleness, but not to flinch. But to call a spade when they try to undermine the truth of the Word of God. I pray for my brothers and sisters today that you would renew them in the battle for the gospel. Renew them in their ministries. Renew them in all that you have called them to do. Those who have received wounds from the enemy, bind up their wounds, for you are a beautiful Savior. You will bind them and you will comfort them, for you said you're the God of all comfort. And you love your soldiers, you love your children, you love them and you will comfort them, for you are Christ the Savior. And I pray that you will bless your people, strengthen your people, encourage your people. And Lord, may your people know your love and grace tonight. Surround them with your protection. And may they take up the challenge today to contend for the faith. And proclaim you, Lord, for you are worthy to be praised, you are worthy to be honored, you are worthy to be glorified, you are worthy to be magnified, you are worthy, O God. Not man, but you. You are our God today and will always be our God. And we give you the praise and the glory and the honor, Lord, and magnify your name, the great almighty God. Bless your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Got a few apologetic videos to make. Don't forget my website, jasonbirdspreacher.com. Have a look at Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones Recording Trust. Great place to get the Word of God. Muslim Journey of Hope is a good website. Answering Islam is a good website. And I like to go to Legionnaire Ministries. Lots of good Bible teacher material there. And I love R.C. Sproul. And Ravi Zacharias Ministries is a good apologetic ministries that will bless you. So thank you for listening. I hope this has been a blessing to you. And God bless you. Take care.